Well, Tim and I go way back. Tim was here as a child in the clinic, and no longer. I think Tim's girth is much bigger and so forth than mine right now. But I remember Tim when he was quite small, and the two of us had many enjoyable times when we were here. Tim, let me start out. And the format this morning is one, I should really speak to that before we continue here. The format is I've come with a number of questions I'd like to present to Tim and for Tim to respond to. And at some point, I'm going to stop and have you guys come on with questions and ask Tim and see where that goes. We generally do that anyway with any of our guest speakers. It's a little bit more informal today than it generally is. I'm going to let Tim take each question initially and roll with it and see where it goes. Okay. So Tim, you've been in the clinic, and as Amanda said, at Fitchburg and so forth. But before we go on with who you are now, what is it that you remember personally about the clinic when you were here? Any thoughts and reflections about your time here at the clinic?
Well, Dr. Huber, let me say it's great to be back here at Bridgewater. And I have many fond memories of being a participant in the clinic. I always enjoyed coming and swimming in the pool. That was always my highlight of my Saturday mornings. I don't know why it was, because the pool was always about 25 degrees. But in any event, I battled the cold and, you know, would hop right in. So I always enjoyed that. I also really appreciated the clinicians and the hard work that they did every Saturday to prepare for the clinic. I met many very nice students while here and really enjoyed being able to be a participant for several years.
Well, you can see right now things have improved. It might have been 25 degrees back then, but it's up around 73 or 74 degrees now.
Well, that's a good thing. I think it would have to be about 80 for me to get in at this point, but...
I may be kidding the students right now, because it is around 83 degrees. They wouldn't admit to that. You have to trust me, Tim. Okay.
Can somebody check the temperature later on and give me a report?
How old were you when you started?
I was about 4 years old when I started at the clinic and continued coming here every semester until around the age of 10. I should comment that my grandfather would often come with me to the clinic, and when I asked him the other day what he remembers about the clinic, he said the best part was the last day of every session when they would bring in D'Angelo sandwiches for lunch. And he would always make sure that he was the first one in line to get the sandwiches. So I guess everyone has different recollections about their memories of the clinic.
How were the sandwiches back then?
Well, I guess they were very good.
Okay. We have to kick this thing off in terms of why you were here. And I would just like to say that I know you as a visually impaired individual, or an individual who's visually impaired. What is the nature of your disability, Tim?
I've been blind since birth. I was born prematurely, and my retina's detached, and as a result, became totally blind. But I never allow blindness to interfere with attaining goals or being able to be productive within society. I always look to find alternative solutions to being able to master whatever challenge might be ahead of me.
Well, you graduated from Fitchburg, and you're currently employed at NSTAR. What is it that you do as an employee of NSTAR?
At NSTAR, I'm a member of the customer service department. There's about 100 of us within the call center. And we handle calls from customers who have accounts with us, who may have billing questions, or from people who feel that their bill is too high. We also receive questions from people who are moving to a specific address and may want to place the electric and or gas account in their name at that new home. Generally, on a daily basis, we take around 100 telephone calls per day. We service about 500,000 gas customers and nearly 1.2 million electric customers from around the state. So it's a very busy, very intense position.
And you've been there how long?
I've been with NSTAR about 2.5 years. It was a very difficult experience trying to find a job, despite the number of advances in Americans with Disabilities Act standards and legal ramifications. Many companies today, unfortunately, are still a little bit hesitant and a little bit uncertain about hiring people with disabilities. So it was great to be able to find NSTAR, but before starting there, I had gone on about 75 to 80 job interviews, which, as many of you, especially those of you that are seniors, know, job interviews are certainly not fun. And so going on multiple interviews and getting asked questions from human resources professionals. For example, one woman, it was an extremely cold day. I had gone into a large company in Boston, and the wind was just biting at your face. And I had gone in there, and the woman said to me, oh, she said, I see that you're blind. She said, are you always going to be blind, or is it just the wind that caused you to be blind today? And when you just, you know, battled the wind and battled your time to come in here to get asked that question, it can be a little bit disheartening. But luckily, I was able to stay with it and persevere and ended up at NSTAR, who've been very accommodating as far as adaptations to their technology and willingness to work with me, so that's made it a good experience.
That's great, Tim. Tim, are you a sports fan?
Well, my favorite team is Ohio State.
You're kidding.
just a bit, yes. I do like sports. Actually, I'm not a huge basketball fan. But I do enjoy hockey. I like the Bruins. I'm a big baseball fan. I was very excited to see that the Red Sox are back on television and on the radio. And so looking forward to the upcoming baseball season.
Well, how important is sport or activity in your life? How important, I mean, it was, you were here in the clinic, but how important is it as you grew up outside of the clinic?
I think sports is very important. I think it shows it and builds a lot of good qualities within a person. For example, you see the teamwork, you see the sportsmanship, those core character qualities, which are so important in all of our lives every day. But I enjoy watching the sports. I enjoy, you know, seeing the different plays and seeing how the players interact with one another.
And do you know I have a favorite team too?
I'm sure you do.
Do we have any team in common?
I'm not sure. Who's your favorite?
well, my favorite is Ohio State also. Can you imagine two people just randomly sitting here having the Buckeyes as a team they follow?
It's really quite a phenomenon. Every Sunday during the football season, when I'm watching the recap of Saturday's games, I always look to see how Ohio State did. And of course, then I always check on Bridgewater State too, just to make sure you guys are doing okay in your football over here. And then of course, I have to check on my friends up in Fitchburg. But so needless to say, I spend a lot of time with the Sunday Globe.
And they have a good sports section.
They do, and actually, the Boston Globe is now available on the telephone. So you can call in, and it's an automated synthetic voice system, and you can select which articles of the paper you'd like to read, and then it will read those articles for you one after the next. So it's great because it provides me with an opportunity to stay up to date on the news or the sports or, you know, human interest stories. So it's really opened up a whole new world.
And you can fast forward to things that you want to look at too.
Exactly. You can choose different articles and different sections of the paper. So it's really excellent.
Well, in terms of us meeting here this morning, I know you came in somewhat of an independent way, but what is your major means of mobility? Do you use a cane, or of course you use a cane, I assume it, but there's no CNI dog.
No, I do not have a guide dog. The guide dogs, I'm not a huge animal lover, unfortunately. So at this point, a guide dog really wouldn't be my first choice. Also, I love the guide dogs. I think that they do a wonderful service. But certainly, they're an animal. They require a lot of work. If you know, if the dog is sick, you certainly need to take him or her to the vet. You know, you need to take the dog out for walks, no matter the weather. I was thinking the other day when we had the pouring rain and the 50-mile-an-hour winds, it really would not have been fun to have a dog that day because you still would have had to go out in that nasty weather to take them out. Whereas with a cane, you can just pick it up and grab it. But I do travel independently every day to and from work. I still reside with family at home in Mansfield. And I take a bus from my house up to the train station and then take the train from Mansfield up to the Route 128 station in Westwood and then take another van from the train station over to NSTAR. It is a lengthy commute, especially when you think that you can just go out, you know, everyone else can just go out and jump in their cars and go from point A to point B. And oftentimes people complain about, you know, gee, these lights are too long, and God, how come I always hit these red lights every day? And I know especially, you know, those of you that have 8 o'clock classes and you've left your house at 7:45 and you know you have a 20-minute commute, those lights seem awfully long, don't they? The transportation is something that I've just had to become accustomed to. I always am pleased when a colleague is able to give me a ride one way. Occasionally I'm able to get a ride to or from work with a colleague, and that's excellent. But if not, you just get used to taking an extra hour to an hour and a half due to the train schedule and the bus schedule to get from one place to another.
Well, that mobility of getting from point A to B, especially a new environment, is part of the challenge that you have. And my question is, I guess getting from home over to NSTAR and learning that route, who actually takes on the responsibility of helping you to be successful of doing that every day or learning new environments?
Sure. Well, the Commission for the Blind is who you go through to obtain those services, and they generally contract them out to the Cal Center for the Blind. And there's a gentleman from the Cal Center that I worked with throughout my time in Mansfield schools and also up at Fitchburg, who has stayed in touch with me regularly, and he provided me with extensive orientation training, both at NSTAR and also at the train stations in Mansfield and in Westwood, so that I felt comfortable and could easily navigate those areas.
Well, you know, things have changed since I last saw you. We had a conversation, and I have a new question for you. And I'm just curious to see how it fits. But I've been reading lately that technology has really moved along for a population who's blind, and that there are a few individuals now who are using GPS systems to get from point A to B. Are you up to date on that, or have you used that at all?
I have seen it demonstrated. I haven't used it. They're very costly systems at the moment to purchase. But I have seen them demonstrated. They do seem quite good. The systems seem to be getting more and more user-friendly and easier to use, which is excellent. As I mentioned, I haven't particularly used them yet, but certainly I think that they are definitely a wave of the future.
Mm-hmm. Well, there's an old saying. One of the classes I teach, and I address issues and challenges of visually impaired and blind individuals. And this statement, you may have heard this before, and it goes something like this. There's a saying that blindness cuts people off from things, while deafness cuts you off from persons. And I'm just wondering, Do you feel that you seek other people out? Like in the deaf community, deaf seek out individuals who are deaf. Being an individual who is blind, do you seek out individuals who are blind as friends or colleagues, or is anyone in the general public a person who you would seek out as a friend or a colleague?
I certainly seek out anyone in the general public. I do have friends who are blind. I think that it's important to have some friends who are blind because you can sometimes relate to them on specific subjects or specific areas that someone who's sighted might not be able to understand. For example, the issues surrounding transportation. You know, oftentimes it's just so easy for people who can see to just go and jump in their cars, and for someone who's blind to have to schedule their transportation, you know, it can be a daunting task and can be a bit stressful and overwhelming at times. So certainly on those issues, I think it's important to have some people who are blind that can kind of relate to the frustrations, but also the joys that you feel. But I do have many friends who are sighted. I met some wonderful people while up at Fitchburg State. While up there, I had a roommate who was excellent, who was very easy to get along with, and also made many other friends while there and stay in touch with several of them today. And I think that having those friendships, just being able to talk to people via phone or via email is just so important. It certainly helps to make you a more well-rounded person.
Well, you know, there's interest within the blind community about the educational process for those who are blind. How effectively can we assist individuals to learn more proficiently and more satisfactory way? And over the last 50 years, we've had some ups and downs with technology coming on board and a little bit of an attempt to put Braille back on the shelf somewhere. But I guess the question to you, Tim, is that in the overall development of the person who's blind, how important is it that they know Braille?
I think that Braille is an extremely critical tool and certainly crucial to someone's overall success. Statistics have shown that people who know Braille have a much better chance of being successful both in their educational opportunities and also in employment opportunities throughout their lives. So I began learning Braille around the age of 4. The Mansfield schools hired a teacher of the visually impaired to come in and teach me Braille, and I would learn that at the same time learning my letters and numbers, at the same time as my sighted friends were learning their print letters and numbers. And I continued with my development of Braille throughout my early years and use it regularly now. I receive books in Braille from the Talking Book Library at Perkins. They send out books and magazines to me regularly that I can read, especially on the train and at home. And so I also have information in Braille that I use at my job at NSTAR. For example, billing terminology and coding that we need to use in order to access customer records. So all of those pieces of information without Braille would place me at an extreme disadvantage.
So you would say that you wouldn't be maybe where you are today without Braille?
Absolutely. I don't think I would certainly be as successful as I am today without that knowledge of Braille and just being able to take notes in Braille and have that information right at your fingertips, just like you would on a piece of paper. Being able to just scan that paper for that vital information is so important. And sometimes, while technology is great, it's a little bit harder to navigate around and find exactly what you're looking for in a real quick manner.
Mm-hmm. Again, turning to technology, do you own a BlackBerry or an iPhone?
I do not have a BlackBerry, but I do have a note-taking device known as PacMate, which is made by Freedom Scientific. And this device talks to me and also has a Braille display. And I write on it using the 6 keys, just like the 6 dots in the Braille system, and am able to then read back the information that I've typed into it and or connected to a computer and actually have the information translated right from the PacMate into a Microsoft Word or Excel document. So it's certainly, having that technology has enabled me to be able to go to meetings and take notes at the meetings and then come back and present those notes to other colleagues or other friends who might need them.
Does this device allow them to text?
It does not. They're still making technology for texting. Just recently, Verizon came out with a talking cell phone that actually allows people to do text messaging. But I certainly have a cell phone and I use it regularly to talk to people, but just haven't gotten into the text messaging yet.
So you're more of a talker than a texter?
Exactly. Okay.
I guess I should
be the one out driving then, as opposed to those people who try to text while they're driving, because that doesn't seem to work too well either.
And everyone knows that's a hot issue on campus this week with the comment that just came out, you've seen it. Tim, in terms of purchasing items in stores or at the coffee shop or wherever, are you a coffee drinker?
Yes, I like tea.
Okay. What about our system of payment, the paper money? Accomplish that in terms of your everyday dealings with purchasing things? I know where I'm coming with that. I saw different sizes of bills when I was over there to equal the amount that each bill was worth. And what challenge does that present to you here in the States?
Well, certainly I think that there's many people right now who are trying to get our money to be more universal. For example, sort of like the system that you're referring to over in Europe, where the bills are different sizes. Generally, I do pretty well with distributing the money and knowing, you know, exactly what needs to be given for a specific item. However, the challenge that you run into is when the store clerks give you back the money that you know that you need in return to equal the total amount of the payment. Oftentimes it's difficult, especially if there's a line, for the clerk to, you know, provide you with the money in a fashion that you can then easily separate it. So quite often I'll just take the money from the clerk and then wait till I'm with someone who can see, who can then help me separate the bills so that I can fold them accordingly, so that I know which bill is which. So it would be wonderful to have a system where we could have different sizes of bills to then make it easier to know exactly what you were being given. I personally have never had an issue where I've been shortchanged by a clerk, but I do have some friends who are blind who have been shortchanged or been given back the incorrect amount of money by store clerks.
Well, so several of the national organizations for the blind are now having a bill, at least it's said to be moving through Congress, to change the size of their bills. Have you heard about that?
Yes, they do have it. It's actually currently in the courts because the Mint is not in favor of it. So they have, it was passed, but they have now, the Treasury has now filed an appeal, an injunction. So it is going to be a very lengthy and grueling process in order to get this actually underway.
Tim, in Massachusetts, there is a state law that's been on the books for a good number of years now, and it focuses on this concept of right turn on red, and it allows drivers to come to a corner. There's a red light, and to make a complete stop, okay, complete stop, and then turn right. Are you in favor of this law?
It's a difficult law in that, you know, certainly you always need to be on your guard when you're a pedestrian and crossing the street, but certainly you also hope that the drivers are on their guard. One thing that we've been trained to do during our orientation classes is generally, if a car is going to be taking a right-hand turn, that car generally pulls up very close to the intersection prior to taking that right. So oftentimes you will notice that the car is much closer than a car who's going to be going straight, who is a little bit closer to the sidewalk as well. So it's important to always listen for those clues to realize whether or not it's going to be safe for you to cross the street. So it's a tricky situation, but certainly I think it, you know, especially with our fast-paced society, everyone wants to get where they're going as quick as they can. But it's important for us as the pedestrian to always be paying 110% attention to what that car might be doing.
So if you're at a corner and you push that button on the light,
yes,
and that white guy flashes and so forth, I mean, you certainly don't see the white guy flash, but you assume the white guy is flashing it.
Well, I certainly hope he is, yes.
Yeah. Doesn't that give you a sense of knowing that you can go there without...
Well, it does give you a sense, but as we all know, there's people who like to run the lights and people who like to do illegal maneuvers on the road. So therefore, it's important to always never place 100% confidence in whether or not all that traffic's going to stop. As the person crossing the street, you need to be listening for the news and realize whether or not it's going to be a safe time to cross the street.
So your request to your audience here this morning would be to have them honor that right turn on red, always stop first?
Exactly.
How do you, when you're at work and you're, and you mentioned 100 people who do similar things that you do, and there's certainly a large number of people in the building, how good are you at distinguishing people by their voice?
I try to be pretty good. It was very difficult when I first started because there were so many people and so many voices. But especially for the people who sit right around me, I do pretty well at getting to know their voice and getting to, you know, interact with them. I've developed an excellent rapport with several colleagues and several of us will meet for lunch and things like that. A few of us have gone out on occasion after work for dinner. So it's an excellent place to be able to get to know new people. It's hard to get to know everyone's voice, but most people have been very understanding. If they think that I may not know who they are, they'll often tell me their name. NSTAR also has another employee within the call center who is blind, so many of my colleagues had familiarity with blindness before I came on board, which certainly made it a little bit easier for me. This other gentleman had kind of been a trailblazer, if you will, and had started that process long before I arrived.
Well, this is a question that's kind of off the wall a little bit, but come with me on this one, okay? You know, our foods have color to them and smells to them, all right? And taste buds were able to distinguish flavors for the most part in terms of I guess the challenge you may have, and maybe there's no challenge, maybe it's me, it could be me, so that let's start with that. But take things that have no colors and smells, such things as ice cream and beer. Are you right on with everyone else in terms of your ability to distinguish flavors?
Absolutely. I certainly enjoy food and enjoy eating. Many of my friends, when I was especially in the public schools in Mansfield, often commented that I used to like to eat fruit. And for example, I like the taste of apricots. And they used to say, wow, you know, those don't look very good. I don't know how you can eat them. And I would say, well, you know, they taste just fine. So oftentimes looks can be deceiving. If you're not looking at something, you might have a different appreciation for what it tastes like than for someone who might be seeing it. So it's, but certainly I haven't missed many meals in my lifetime, so I guess I must be doing okay with where I'm eating.
Well, stay with me on this one too. This is a little off the wall. When you're in a new environment, probably with people that you're not as familiar with as you might be at your area at NSTAR or maybe at home. But this is a new environment and you're thrown into that for some reason, and a lot of those people you don't know, okay, for example. So how is Tim in this environment? Is Tim going to be Tim as he generally is, are you going to, or is Tim going to, because he's, you're in a new environment, and maybe you have to do a lot of different things in this new environment, move around and so forth, are you going to ask fewer questions than you generally would during your work day, or will you ask more questions? Or just how, you know where I'm going with that question, probably. Go ahead.
I think I have a pretty good idea. I think that when I'm in a new environment, as with most people, I try to assess the environment first, try to see the culture of that environment, how people communicate within the environment, and try to get used to that situation and before jumping in. I often would ask more questions just because of my unfamiliarity with the situation, trying to gauge how things might work or how the situation might be going during that particular day. So I like to ask questions, but also like to receive the feedback from other people. For example, if I'm doing something that's not quite right, having someone tell me that it isn't, you know, what's going on at the moment so that I can rectify the situation. Going into a new environment can be a little bit scary and overwhelming. For example, I'm not very fond of traveling because every hotel you go to is set up differently. You know, one hotel might have, when you go into the lobby, you know, it might be a large open area with nothing to really trail or to guide you to where you're going. Whereas other hotels might have tables and counters and reception desks, and then when you get up to the room, all of the hotel rooms are set up differently. Some rooms there might be, you know, the bathroom might be right as soon as you enter the room. Other rooms you may go in and the beds are right there and the bathroom is further over. All of these may seem like minor inconveniences to many of you, but to me they can be overwhelming because you know that you need to, you know, get around this brand new area, and if you don't have someone with you who can see, it can be very, very frightening, especially when you're thinking, you know, what's going to happen in the middle of the night if I need to get out because of a fire alarm, or if, you know, if I need to find the bathroom, how do I do it? So that can be overwhelming. So I'm not real fond of going to new environments, but when I am placed in that new situation, it's just important to try to remain as calm as you can, and then look at that situation as an opportunity to grow and learn from other people.
Yeah, you know, as long as I've been in this field, I just had a thought here about what you just presented as a challenge to you. Talk about ADA for a minute. You know, I guess in terms of ADA, as long as you have certain railing within rooms, I guess that's pretty much what is expected. But there should be maybe what you're saying, some universality to a room for within a hotel, that all hotels have certain rooms that ought to be similar to all other hotel rooms across the country, so that you can cut down the time that you have to spend getting to know the room.
Exactly. I think that would be a wonderful thing, except I think that in today's society, where architecture and the aesthetic appeal of buildings is so important to our society, that people are looking for that difference. It's that difference in the layout, or that difference in how a lobby of a hotel might be presented, that is intriguing, especially to people who might be thinking about bringing a large group there. Before I worked at NSTAR, I worked for several summers during high school and college for Colette Vacations, which is a very large tour operator within the United States and also abroad. And every year they often change hotels because, you know, a hotel may have just undergone a multi-million dollar renovation, and therefore it's got all these new features which are so appealing to people who can see, but yet for someone who's blind, they present a whole new set of challenges. So it's an interesting idea to have everything be equal, but at the same time, the hotels are looking for that new and special idea or special creation that sets them apart from the competitor that's down the street. But I mean, the same thing applies, you know, when I first started up at Fitchburg State, trying to find my way around the campus and find my way, you know, from one building to another or from the dorm to the cafeteria. Certainly, I learned my way from the dorm to the cafeteria very quickly. I didn't want to be, you know, without food. Being able to find my way around was a little bit overwhelming at first, but over time it became easier. So I think that it's just important to get used to those situations and how to best accommodate those.
Is it fair to say, in terms of the use of terminology here, that in an environment there's the whole, and I as a seeing person can see the whole instantaneously, and a person who is blind comes into a room and gradually gets to know that room, but they get to know it in splinters, but they put those splinters more and more together to create that whole, but maybe never really, really achieving the whole.
Exactly. I mean, there are certain areas that you get to know very well, and there's other areas that if you don't visit them that often, you really don't get to know them. The other day, I was up at the Route 128 train station, and the escalator was out of service. And so I didn't really think much of it until I got there and said, well, I wonder how the heck you get down if the escalator's out of service. So there was a MBTA police officer there, and he came over and asked me if I needed some assistance. And I said, well, yes, you know, how do I get to the area where I'm going to be meeting the van to go up to NSTAR? And he explained to me that, you know, we had to go down this elevator, and then when we got down the elevator, you had to go to the left and then to the right and through a door, and then you get there. And I'm thinking, oh, this sounds way too complicated, especially at 8:30 in the morning when, you know, I haven't had my morning cup of coffee and tea yet. So I said to him, I said, you know, do you mind going with me? And he was more than willing to go down with me and get me to where I was going. But one thing I think I try to impress on all of you today is that if you ever see someone who's visually impaired or blind that looks like they might be a little bit lost or might just need a little bit of extra guidance, always feel free to go over it and offer them that assistance. Some people who are blind may not want it or may not feel they need it, but I'm someone who always appreciates having someone come over and offer to assist me, because most likely if I look like I'm lost, I probably am. So having someone to come over and offer that assistance can be a very reassuring situation.
You're familiar with the deaf population, that they have close capacity to assist them with visuals on TV or the movie. And certainly you are familiar with the DVS, or Descriptive Video Service. I'm going to pull back from it and just let you talk about that. Is it how that may impact you? And first of all, probably what it is.
Well, Descriptive Video Service is a service which describes the visual elements on a television program or in a movie, so that you can go and enjoy the same movie as your friends are seeing. For example, now, when Descriptive Video first started, it was on videos. Now it's been made available in many theaters throughout the state of Massachusetts, where you can go and put on a headset, and when there is no one talking during the video, when none of the characters are speaking, this person doing the description will talk into the headset and tell you exactly what the visual elements are that are on the screen. It's a great service. I haven't been to too many movies with it, just because I'm kind of cheap and don't like to spend $12 or $15 to pay for movie tickets when I can, you know, watch the movie a few months later when it comes out on DVD. But certainly it's a great service. And it's also become popular within theaters for local theatrical shows. Several of the Boston theaters, the Wang Center, and several of those have started producing their plays with a couple of shows that include the description. Again, the people who are attending the show wear their headset, and when there are visual aspects going on the stage, someone is sitting in a booth and describing those aspects to your eyes through your headset. So I've been able to experience some great musicals, Phantom of the Opera and Les Mis and The Nutcracker, all with description, which is really exciting, and is going to make things so much better as it becomes more widely used.
You know, the G section of the Globe, they have highlights throughout the week, but more importantly on weekends, for all the movie theaters that shows are being shown that particular day or weekend.
Yes.
And are you aware of that at the top of the, or stringing across the top of those advertisements are indicators of which movie theaters and which shows have DBS?
That is excellent. It's something that has recently been started in the newspapers. For a while, we, within the blindness community, I have been subscribed to an email list, and they would put out a weekly email telling you which shows and which theaters were going to have the described video availability. But it's great that it's now in the papers, which makes it more widely known, in case people who may not have email or may not have a computer can still receive that information.
Okay. Here's one for you, Tim. Do you dream? And if so, how is that?
I do dream, and it's amazing how many people ask that question. It's a question that I never think about, but comes up in almost every speaking engagement that I do. I do dream, and generally my dreams are auditorily based. For example, you know, I don't see someone in the dream or see any images, but actually hear them. Sometimes I think, you know, I hear dead people, or, you know, whatever that line is from the movie. But I do hear voices, and I'm able to kind of relate in the dream auditorily as opposed to visually.
And in terms of your everyday organization, I know myself getting dressed in the morning, getting organized and so forth. I still want to look sharp, be sharp, you know how that is, and you want to be color coordinated. How is it that you can prepare for your everyday day or week in terms of what you wear and what matches, and how do you keep all that straight?
Well, appearance is very important to me. I think that it's very important, no matter if you are blind or not, to have a good appearance. It makes an impression on people who can see you every day. I have a machine that tells me the color of items. I try to keep to neutral colors that would go easily together, so that there isn't as much memorization that's needed. Since I don't have any light perception, I'm really not familiar with colors other than from what people have told me. So therefore, if I can stick to more neutral tones, it can make it much easier to place a particular shirt with a particular pair of pants and know that I'm going to look fine together when everything is going to be coordinated.
Do you have anything wild in your wardrobe?
I try not to go too wild. No, I like to you know, be calm and collected every morning.
Okay. Well, I'm going to stop here and turn it over to the guests this morning and let them fire away at you, okay?
That sounds perfect.
Okay.
When I went to Merrimack College, I had a friend who lived on my hall, and she had some vision, but it was not, she didn't have any color perception. She had some vision where she could tell if someone was there. She couldn't really see, she could just see black and white.
Sure.
But she could tell who was coming by hearing your footsteps. Is that something you can do, or is that...
She must be really talented. I gotta go take lessons from her.
That's how she would know who was. She would just listen, and she would know who everyone was in the hallway by listening to our footsteps. And I don't know why or how she did that, but it was very interesting.
It certainly is interesting. I have never thought about doing that. I suppose that everyone, you know, probably has different footsteps or might wear, you know, different shoes, but I would think that would be a very difficult process to try to identify someone by their footsteps. Voices is hard enough.
Hi, Tim. My question is, what's your greatest difficulty, like, on a day-to-day basis? And you mentioned your commute to work and, like, the difficulties that can be associated with that. And also, what can we do, like, as a general public to improve of those situations and the difficulties that you encounter?
Good questions for Saturday morning. Apparently, you guys didn't go out partying last night. Seems to me I always did that at Fitchburg on a Friday night, but I guess I'm in the minority, I don't know. I think there are several difficulties and challenges to overcome. Certainly transportation is a major challenge. I think it would be great if there was a system where you could actually take one mode of transportation and get from where you are to where you're going. Certainly that would make things much easier. The other challenge is, I think, acceptance of people who have a disability and being able to realize that although someone has a disability, they're still able to be an active member of society. So often, as I mentioned earlier, when I went out on job interviews, people had no knowledge of what someone who was blind could do. I had one gentleman one day, I was going to be doing some inside sales work for his company, and he said to me, he said, well, I couldn't hire you because people who are blind don't know how to dial telephones. And I said to him, I said, well, you know, that's interesting. Where did you learn that? I said, because I haven't heard that. And he said, oh, well, he said, it's true. You know, everyone who's blind doesn't know how to use a phone. And I said, well, I've been using one since, you know, I was 5 or 6 years old. I don't think there's a problem. I said, would you like me to demonstrate? He said, oh, no, you might break it. So I think it's trying to get people to realize that although someone has a disability, for example, someone who's blind, that they can still do many of the same things. They may do them in a different way, but in the end, it can be the task can be accomplished. I read a study recently, just a couple of weeks ago, that was just done amongst the general public within the United States. And blindness is feared amongst the general public as much as meeting someone who has AIDS. And I thought that was quite a statement, because I never think of blindness as anything to be feared. I always think of it as just a minor challenge to overcome. God bless you. But apparently it's more feared than that among the general public.
Hey Tim, which party life did you enjoy more, high school or college?
There were some good parties in college. In high school, I think that there were many kids who didn't quite know how to really interact with me. So, I mean, I had friends in high school, but not a lot of close friends. In college, I met a lot more people and went out to a lot more gatherings. I didn't go to a ton of parties, but we often would go out. There'd be a lot of comedians who would come to campus or music groups who would come, and we would often go out and see them at night. So certainly I had an active college experience.
Yes, back there.
It sounds like, you know, with interviews you had your fair share of difficulties with people who are ignorant, but you seem very, very positive. What is your philosophy? I mean, I know sometimes life can be tough, but...
Well, life can be tough, but you just have to make the most out of it. I mean, you can either sit at home all day and wallow in your sorrows and, you know, never get out of bed, or you can just get up and make the most of it. And every day, no matter what profession or what your situation might be, you know you're going to run into people who have different views and different philosophies. So it's just important to be able to keep an open mind. I always try to educate people to help them to understand about blindness in hopes that, you know, maybe what I've shared with them, even if it's just one or two little tidbits, might be able to give them a better understanding and appreciation for a situation that they might be in the future.
question I have is an extension of a lot of things we've talked about, and that is the wide world that's out there beyond Mansfield and home and NSTAR and work and traveling locally and nearby with friends. What's the world look like to you in terms of your own personal interests? I'm talking about traveling and engaging in other countries and their foods and their people and getting a sense for the larger world outside of Southeast Massachusetts.
Well, I'm always interested in learning new things. I've certainly traveled to other parts of the country, and in April I'm going to be traveling down to see my brother, who's a graduate student at the University of Maryland. So I always enjoy being able to see new areas, to be able to experience new types of food, and certainly even within the United States, there's different areas that have different food tastes. For example, in Maryland, you're always going to have those crab cakes. So it's important to always try new things. I always like the opportunity to experience a new situation and to be able to make the most of that situation. I have never traveled internationally, but certainly there might be something to consider somewhere down the road.
Okay. Yeah.
In terms of technology, what do you use for technology since you don't have any form of sight?
The computer talks to me, so everything that's on the screen, it converts into a spoken word. I'm able to write emails, go on the internet, go on Facebook. Sometimes I wish I could see some of the photos on Facebook, but that hasn't happened yet. And be able to write documents. And at work, the computer also talks to me, so I use a headset, and I'm able to hear the customer in one ear and the computer in the other, so I'm able to access the database and provide information to the customer at the same time as I'm talking with the customer. I'm listening to the information from the computer in the other ear. So the technology has really opened up a whole new world and provided so much and so many opportunities, and it's certainly just going to continue to increase as technology increases.
Well, we also, I found out something else about you this morning, I didn't realize, in terms of your brother. He's a Terp.
He is.
Yeah. Well, I'm a Terp, too. I became a Terp before I became a Buckeye.
Oh, okay.
I was there for my master's degree, and blue shell crab is like the best.
Excellent. Well, I'll have to try it. I've never been to the University of Maryland. I'm going to go down there at the end of April. I'm going to take in a Red Sox game at Camden Yards.
Good.
And see Greg's campus. He is also a graduate student. He's majoring in regional planning. So go down there and see his campus and spend the weekend in Baltimore and the Inner Harbor.
That's great. The Inner Harbor is beautiful.
That's what I've heard.
Some good nightlight there, too.
Oh, excellent. Well, I'll be all set.
Okay, Amanda.
Tim, as a token of our appreciation here at CPDC, we would like to present you with this lecture.
Thank you very much, Amanda.
Thank you very much.
So was this more fun than doing paperwork?
Yes.
Before we go, I know of Tim's interest, at least. Tim's been brainwashed. He says he's a Buckeye fan. I hope that he is, but he's been with me all these years. And when he was here as a child in clinic, I used to tease him about Ohio State a little bit, didn't I?
Absolutely.
You know? So as a second gift that we have here for Tim, I have an official, okay, Ohio State football jersey. Okay. And on the back of it, there's some sayings that hopefully Tim will live by and cherish as he wears this with a great deal of pride. And you can wear this when you go down and see your brother and tell him that this is from a bigger or larger university.
If I do that, I probably won't be coming back home alive. But
Tim, really, thanks for coming this morning and pitch hitting for the person who wasn't able to. It's always a great pleasure to have you, and I'm sure that our conversation, or at least our give and take here this morning, has given our students a look into your world and maybe some things that they learned here this morning that will assist them in terms of working with individuals, children, adolescents, mm-hmm. even adults who might be blind.
Absolutely, and certainly I hope it has, and it's been great to be here, and if anybody has any further questions, you can certainly come down and ask one-on-one, or give them to Dr. Huber, and he will get in touch with me, and we'll be glad to answer those for you.
Okay. Well, in terms of the morning and going over there, just remember that we're going out side door of Maxwell this morning and going into the small gym side of the building and through the large gym to pick up our children. And we'll see you over there. Anyone with a question, personal question for Tim, come on down now.